Welcome to Ox Tools. I'm Tom. Today we have a little problem that came in from one of my blog readers or YouTube subscribers. I can't remember which. Jay is having some trouble with straight knurling. Straight knurling is a gripping surface for a screw head or a knob or something like that. It's pretty common. Although my experience is that when people have trouble on the lathe, there's two things they have trouble with. One is parting, and the other one's knurling. One of the reasons people have trouble with knurling is that they don't do it very often. It just doesn't come up that often. And sure, you know, you want to make a little knob or something like that, and you want to do it. Well, you spend all this time on this knob, and then you knurl it, and it doesn't come out the way you want it, so you're kind of pissed off because you put all the work into it, because knurling is typically one of the last things that you do. So people just want knurling to come out and happen, and that isn't always the case. So we're going to work through an example for Jay and see if we can help him out and do some good straight knurling. I don't have a knurling tool myself. I haven't bought one yet because I don't do it very often and they're kind of expensive. So I generally do something like you see here on this guy here, as I do flutes or something like that. That's usually how I put a gripping surface on a knob. In fact, I just did this one. So here's the short story is that I borrowed this knurling tool, and unfortunately it was on a Loris AX size tool block. So, and I have a CX, which is quite a bit bigger, so there's just no way it's going to fit. But what a Loris does is this knurling head is bolted onto the tool block, and it's pinned so that the pinning takes the load and keeps everything nice and straight. So what I did is I said, okay, well, I'll just make a holder, and I made a quickie holder here, and I used my trick with the half-inch round bars welded on to create the dovetail for the CX size holder, and then I just used some cold roll flat bar I had laying around, and now this the knurling head is mounted to a larger holder and it fits my lathe now. So we got these are diamond knurls in here right now, and these are the crown style of diamond knurls. When I do knurl, I kind of prefer those. They have a lead in and a lead off. And the contact face is narrower, so you don't have to reef on it so hard on the cross feed to imprint the material. So anyway, we're gonna use that. So I hunted around and I found some straight knurls, and these are these are 25 teeth per inch. So these are made by Reed. AS25 is the numbers that's on them. I think Jay's is a 21 TPI is what he's working with. So he sent me a little note, and so his problem is around 7/8 diameter and 21 pitch or 21 teeth per inch. So I'll show you in a second how you figure out what diameters that you can knurl with a particular set of knurls. That's one of the things that people get tripped up on is they think they can just go up any diameter that happens to be in the lathe and just throw a knurl on it. Well, that isn't quite the case. It doesn't work out that way. It's kind of like gear teeth, just like this. And the circumference has to work out for the number of teeth. Whether you're using teeth per inch or dimetral pitch, like you'd see in a diamond knurling, and they use dimetral pitch systems for making knurls also. But in this case, it's teeth per inch. So, I don't have my Allen right.
just...
So the knurl he's trying to do here is something like you might see on a brass thumb screw. This has a straight knurl on it here. I'm not sure if you can see that or not. And this one's a little coarser here, it looks like, smaller. And this is nice, you know, just for small type knobs. Pretty good. So what we'll do is we'll change the camera setup a little bit, and I'll show you how to work out the diameters if you want to knurl a particular diameter, or if you want to knurl something around a particular diameter, and how you will figure out if the knurls that you have are going to work. And then we'll go ahead and go over to the lathe, and we'll knurl a diameter. I don't have any 7/8 brass bar stock. I just got some bigger stuff, but it'll be good for an example for what we're doing here today. Okay. So knurling tools, straight knurls, and I'll be right back. Okay, so we're back. So we're doing the straight knurl thing. We got these knurls here. These are 25 TPI. So they're all right. Yeah, 25 TPI. 25 TPI knurls. And so the first thing we want to do is we want to figure out, you know, what diameters we can knurl. So what we do first is we say 1 over 25. And if you do the calculations, that gives you the distance between the teeth, okay? So it's we need to know this to work out the diameter. So the diameter Jay's working with is 875. And if we take 875, that diameter, we multiply it by pi, we get some number, 0.875, enter, 3.1416 times. So that equals 2.7489. Okay. So now what I want to do is I want to see how this divides into that. I'm looking for a whole number with no remainder. So what we're going to do is we're going to take our 2.7489 divide by 0.040 divide. So that equals 68.7225. Okay, so you see there's a whole number here, 68, and then we got some spare change over here. This is our problem right here, so we need to get rid of that. So we can go up to 69, or we can go down, or excuse me, we can go to 68, we can take that remainder off, or we can jump up to 69. So let's see what 68 gives us. If we use that as a whole number, we're going to take 68, and then we're going to multiply that by 040, okay? So 68.040 times, that equals 2.72, okay? And then we're going to divide that by pi. 3.1416 divide, okay? So if we divide that by pi, that equals 0.8658. So that right there is the diameter that these 25 TPI straight knurls want to run on. So that's 68 teeth with no remainder. So that's pretty close. That's only 10 thousandths less than what the Jay's working with. Although he has 21 pitch rolls, which work out a little bit better, I think. So let's jump up to 69 and see what that looks like, since I'm going to be turning this down, and it's just less to turn down. So we're going to take 69 and 0.040 times 2.1416 divide. So 878. Oh, that's even closer. Okay, so if we go to 69 times 40 thousandths equals 0.878. 5. Okay, so I think that's going to be our target number there. So we'll have 69 teeth, and it'll be 8.785. This number is not super fussy. You want to be pretty close to it. Usually I like to be just a whisker bigger, if anything. And I don't have a good answer why I like to be a whisker bigger. I don't know why. So somebody told me that a long time ago, maybe, and it stuck in my head. So anyway, we're going over to the lathe now. We're going to turn this thing down to 8.79, something like that. I'll put the knurls in the holder, and I'll show you how to set up the holder and all that. Okay, so over here on the lathe, we got some brass bar stock in here. We've got our Tom special holder here. I put in, and we'll change these knurls out now. And whatever side the writing's on, I always just out of habit, put it on the same side on both of them. It probably doesn't make any difference. Just, workman-like habit, right? Make everything the same. And then here you can see these are crowned diamond knurls here that I like. Oop. I probably should have done this while it was on the bench, but that's okay. Alright, let's get these out of the way. Alright. So we get a couple of adjustments here. You got a diameter adjustment, and then you got a height adjustment here like this, and then you also have a squareness. And all these are kind of important. Actually, the least important one is the spacing between these. I haven't found that to affect much at all. I just open it up so that I can see what I'm doing in there. And obviously, if you were doing a much smaller diameter. I want to hit it at, 7 and 10 or something like that, or 10:30 and 6:30 or something like that in there. But what's important is that when we feed in, that they both come into contact at the same time. So I'll spin the lathe and I'll bring it in, and what I'm looking for is that they start turning when I just kiss the material. They start turning at the same time, so that's one thing I'm looking for. So this diameter isn't right, but it'll work for kind of calibrating these the height and whatnot. So we'll come up. So I'm just going to eyeball it first and look at it. So I'm way too high right now, I can see that. See, that one's touching, that one's not touching. Okay, that's pretty close. This one's dragging and this one's not is stopped. Let me come out. Let's try that. There we go. Okay, so they're both locked in. So I'm gonna call that height good. And just kind of snug the lock down here a little bit. Okay, so now, we could just knurl this diameter too, I suppose. Let's go ahead and we'll do Jay's example. I may have to reset it.
slightly, but I'll check it again when I pull it out.
So let's turn this down. Thousands or something like that. This is 360 brass. This is plain Jane, run-of-the-mill stuff. Nothing fancy. All right, 890. What are we looking for? 880. So about 10,000 to go. Knock a little chamfer on here just to help things get started. All right, let's see what we got here. Okay, that's close enough. 8785. All right, let's put our Knurling tool back in here. All right, so we're gonna make some adjustments here. That's not even touching. We'll bring these together. And sure, why not? That's my 10 and 7 roughly there. All right, let's try our position here. This looks pretty good still. Okay, that one caught, and that one caught. Okay, well, my height stayed good. That's nice. Okay, so, all right, let's set some speeds, and
We're going to run this at, what are we going to run this at here? Say about 200 RPM, something like that. So this is another thing that people get messed up with is, what speed do I run it at? Most people knurl pretty slow, and I'm not sure why. The knurls are kind of, they're high speed, so technically they can cut like high speed tools, although they're expensive, so people want to preserve them. So there's not any danger in going too slow typically, and there's a danger in going too fast. So this is brass, high speed rolls. I'm going to run 200 RPM, which is pretty slow. You could probably run 600 and be fine, but it's a lot easier to see the action when we're doing it that way. We're doing it a little slow there. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is I know my tool post is pretty square because I keep it real square, so I'm not going to mess around with that. We'll take a look at the pattern. We'll get in close and look at that pattern after we make a pass, and it'll tell us everything we want to know about how square it is. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to come up and I'm just going to touch the rolls, and then what I want to do is I'm going to set my dial here just so I have a reference point so I know how far I'm in feeding, because if you go too far it starts to break the tips of the teeth up, or excuse me, the tips of the knurled material, and you get slivers and flakes off of it because you're knocking the tops off of the mountains there, right? So you're not quite going to a sharp peak, so it should still be slightly blunted, although it's kind of a fine line there. So we'll do a pass, see what it looks like, and then maybe do another pass. Okay, so I've kind of zeroed it. I'm going to come off of the piece. Feed rate for this, and most people underfeed also, thinking that more revolutions kind of imprints it better. But really, you have this wide roll surface, so you can feed the heck out of these things axially. So we're going to set up about 12 or 15 thousandths feed. Excuse me, I got the burps here. Okay. All right, so that ought to do that. All right, let's take a look and see what that looks like. Pretty good. That's 12 and a half thousandths per rev feed at 200 RPM. Let me get close here, and I'm not going to use any lube on this. The brass makes the brass chips stay on the material. It doesn't flush them away. So we're going to do it dry. I'll probably just blow a little bit of air. I'm just going to come up and take a look. Okay, it looks like they're both touching off pretty good. Okay, so I'm going to dial in some crossfeed here. Let's go 40 thousandths. See what we get. Alright, it's fully engaged now. I'm gonna stop it, pull it out, see what it looks like. Okay, so I'm going to bring in, I'm going to reset the camera and bring in closer so you can take a look at this. It's not bad, actually. It could be a little bit deeper, but we got a little bit more left we can go here. So, okay, so there you can kind of see the knurl up close.
And let me kick it out of gear here. Kind of spin it around so you can see what's going on there. So it's not bad. It could be a little bit deeper. So that was 40 thousandths in feed in one shot on an 879 diameter, something like that. So let's take another pass and see what it looks like. Okay, so I dialed in another 10 thousandths feed, or excuse me, in feed. Oop. And we're going to take another pass on that and see if that does it. Okay, I don't see much in the way of flakes coming off of there, so I'm thinking that's pretty good. Okay, I see a little bit on the rolls here, so I think we got a pretty good depth there. Oh yeah. So it's just starting to flake a little bit, and we can you see a little bit of stuff's coming off of there. So first cut was 40, and now this is 50 deep. I'm gonna call that pretty good. That's nice and crisp there, feels good. Let's compare it to our... let's compare it to these. Oh yeah, well these are... that one's pretty good there. That's a pretty good one there. Screw machine, little double hit there. This one's finer here. But these are pretty nice ones here on these knobs. They come up to a nice point. This is looking pretty good too, though. So my tool post is not quite perfectly square. I can see that looking at this. It's a little deeper on one side than the other, so looks like I need to swivel this way just a whisker. Well, let's go ahead and do that, and we'll run another pass and see what happens here. The trick is just moving it a little bit. Okay. That was a little bit. So I'm going to run it through. I'll run it through on my 40 setting, I think. Yeah, let's try that. Okay, experimenting here now. Okay. It happens about a year. Bit of flaking now, so we're probably tearing it a little bit. We're too deep now. Yeah, actually, not too bad. Well, it's definitely more uniform in depth across the length of the knurl. See, I'm double cutting here a little bit because I'm getting some flakes, or I'm knocking the tops off. Although, that's not bad. So So one thing with knurling is that, you know, if you want to practice knurling, you can start with a big diameter like this and do the math on it. And then just work your way down, and so you're not just throwing all this material away, you know, trying to just do this diameter, right? So you can work out the bugs on a larger diameter. And, you know, typically you would just be knurling a small area normally. You know, you're not going to put 6 inches of this on anything unless you're making a whole bunch of knobs or something like that. But so typically you wouldn't be doing that. So that's not a bad knurl right there for, you know, right out of the gate. And there's some fuzz coming off of these here. So I like the tool post angle better now. So I think I'll turn that down, and then I'm going to be coming up. Never mind. I'm not going to do it. So anyway, there's some tips for straight knurling there, and now I have I got something out of the deal too, because I have a holder that fits my lathe that I can borrow this Aloris head if I have some knurling to do, and which isn't very often. Okay, so that's it for the lathe, and I'll be right back. All right, so here's a close-up of that knurl, and you can kind of see pretty good for right out of the gate. Not perfect. If we fiddle around with it a little bit more, we could make it pretty damn good. So once again, tool post angle, correct diameter, and feed rate. Those are your big deals there on knurling. Okay. Okay, so that's about it for the knurling video. I hope you guys liked it, and I had a little bit of fun there, and got to play around with making a piece of tooling, which is always fun. And now if I need to knurl here on my big lathe, I got a tool post that I can set up pretty quickly. So. Thanks, Jay, for an interesting problem that probably a lot of people have some interest in sorting out. So what I recommend is people do a little practice with knurling before they have to do it on an important part. I have felt the frustration of spending a lot of time on a part, cutting threads and doing all kinds of operations, and then making a bad knurl. Very frustrating, and I've been there, okay? So it's do yourself a favor, do a little practicing on the same material, same diameters, same knurling and all that, and kind of work out your parameters, and so you get a good knurl. A little bit of material is a good teacher for that, since we don't all knurl very often, okay? Some shops do it all the time, but most places don't. So that's about all I have for today, and thanks again for watching, and I'm Tom and Ox Tools, and just remember, get out in the shop and just start on something and get cracking, okay? So see you guys later. Thanks a lot.